This book is about a much more specific group of people in the first half of the 20th century, basically from the very end of the 19th century, going through to 1946. Bhagat Singh got up one morning, turned up in the Central Assembly and threw a bomb. Why did he do it? Or, you know, suddenly out of thin air, Netaji turns up in Singapore and sets up the Indian National Army. That's totally not the case. So let me give you a little brief history. Really, at the end of the 19th century, you have a new kind of armed resistance that rises with this group. And the first generation of them were led by two interesting characters. One was Aurobindo Ghosh. Many of you may know him as Sri Aurobindo. And the other was Savarkar. And what they did was create a network of akhadas, which are known as the Alushilan Samiti. And these akhadas were made up of young men mostly, but also occasionally women.
Good evening. This is a very interesting book. So we are going to skip the book reading and allow you to read the book yourselves. Because history, the way this book has been written and the following discussion will show you, has become a very controversial. It has become one-sided, and the corrections that this book attempts to make are worthy of your time, your energy, and maybe even your careers. This book, I've been waiting for this book for 8 years. That's the time that he has taken to write this book. We met, in 2014, the first time. And after that, since then, we've been discussing, he's been talking about that book. It's a much awaited book. So when I came to know that it's finally being published, I said, this is the first book I want to read in 2023. It's gripping. It's insightful. It's heart-wrenching. At points, if you value our independence, our freedom, it brings tears to your eyes. Not just in the manner in which people have been killed and given their lives or made sacrifices, but the manner in which post-independence they have been thrown aside into the garbage bins of yesterday. Sanjeev has salvaged several of them for us. How many of you feel that we won our independence through peace? De di hame azadi bina. How many of you believe that to be true? Can you please raise your hands? I'm glad you already have a recipient, because that is not true. We won our Azadi through violence also. Sanjeev, could you just tell us more about the violence, the first part, just the violence as a tool for freedom?
Thank you very much for that kind introduction. Let me say that I wrote this book particularly because I always felt the story of our independence struggle just didn't add up. This whole idea that, you know, we politely requested the British to leave and they gently left doesn't quite add up. Especially since, at least in my family, both from my mother's and father's side, they were revolutionaries, very much part of this armed struggle that I have written about. There are several granduncles and great-granduncles and so on who were beaten to death, were hanged, were sent to Kalapani and so on. So in some ways, this is also a personal book. But the fact is that the armed resistance against foreign domination goes back a very long way, not just to the British period, but, you know, much, much earlier invasions also were resisted. But even the resistance to the British starts at the very least in the 18th century. There are waves of resistance to the British, the Marathas, the Sikhs, the Great Revolt of 1857. This book is not about that longer history. This book is about a much more specific group of people in the first half of the 20th century, basically from the very end of the 19th century, going through to 1946. And this group of people were very interesting because they were essentially resisting, of course, as you mentioned, they were resisting British rule through the armed resistance. But even if you know some of these names, by the way, this is fairly recent history. There are still people around who knew many, who saw some of these events. But even though you may know the name of Bhagat Singh or Netaji or Rashbehari Bose or Chandrashekhar, Azad or whatever, you get the impression that somehow, you know, they were random acts of violence, that somehow one day, what I want to actually do here is to show that there is not just violence, But it is a systematic movement that these people were being a part of.
Yeah, basically, the fact that India did not win its independence by non-violence alone, not through ahimsa, but also through hinsa. This is not to undermine ahimsa, but to give hinsa its place in the freedom struggle, is part one. Part two is, we remember, like he just mentioned, we remember the sacrifice of Chandrashekhar Azad. We remember the sacrifice of Bhagat Singh. We remember Rajguru, as though they were individual islands of nationalism. One man standing up against the British and dying for the country. No, that's not the case. As Sanjeev proves, which is the second point of the book, that not only did we win our war of independence through violence, but the segregated acts of violence that are taught to us in our history books are incorrect. They were related.
If at all.
Sanjeev.
In fact, if at all. First of all, you're taught very little about them. And to the extent you're taught about, you will get up, Bhagat Singh got up one morning, turned up in the Central Assembly and threw a bomb. Why did he do it? Or, you know, suddenly out of thin air, Netaji turns up in Singapore and sets up the Indian National Army. That's totally not the case. So let me give you a little brief history, sort of overarching idea of how...
Tell us the networks and also the Indian segregated all across that map of India. Yeah. Plus the international
Absolutely.
Linkages.
India, after 1857, for a period, was under absolute shock. The British had absolutely decimated everybody. There was the odd, you know, revolt by traditional India. You saw the Manipuri nobility rise up, or Birsa Munda and the tribals of Jharkhand rise up. But they were not really a threat to the British. So it's really at the end of the 19th century, you have a new kind of armed resistance that rises with this group. And the first generation of them were led by two interesting characters. One was Aurobindo Ghosh. Many of you may know him as Sri Aurobindo. And the other was Savarkar. And what they did was create a network of akhadas, which are known as the Anushilan Samiti. And these akhadas were made up of young men mostly, but also occasionally women. Not much younger than most of you. About the same age, I would say. They were in the late teens, early 20s. And they decided to take up the attempt to cause for freedom. They also wrote a whole bunch of books. That is the other important thing to remember. So they were influenced by, of course, Hindu revivalism. They were also influenced by Pan-Asianism of the Japanese, by Mazzini, Irish, all kinds of different influences. But this particular round of resistance basically breaks apart. It happens because many of them are arrested. They're sent off to Kalapani, hanged in some cases, and so on. But then what happens is that one of the disciples of Sri Aurobindo, called Rashbehari Bose, takes it up. And he then begins to create another network along with a granduncle of mine, incidentally, called Sachindra Nath Sanyal. And they begin to revive this network of akhadas. In 1912, by the way, Rashbehari Bose, not far from here, in Chandni Chowk, threw a bomb on Lord Hardinge and nearly killed him. And most amusingly, he then went back to Dehradun where he was working, and then he organized an event where he condemned the bombing in the harshest terms. And they were so pleased with this that when Lord Hardinge 6 months later came back after recovering from the bomb attack, he was the leader of the welcoming committee. Anyway, then the First World War starts. Sachin Sanyal and Rashbehari Bose then attempt to cause a revolt in the Indian Army. And this revolt nearly succeeds just a couple of days before the revolt was supposed to take off. The British find out about it. At the last minute, they change all the guards of all the armories. So this great revolt doesn't actually take off, except in Singapore, where they hadn't heard that this had happened and the troops in Singapore rise in revolt. But this fails. The Germans attempt to supply arms to various revolutionary groups. Some of these revolutionary groups end up fighting in Persia against, guess who? General Dyer. So you've heard of the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. General Dyer originally made his name fighting the Indian revolutionaries in Balochistan-Persia border. That's how he originally made his name. And here as well, there was a revolutionary called Bagha Jatin, who was shot dead on the Odisha coast because he was waiting there for the German arms to be supplied to him. They were about to be dropped, but they also got, that also didn't happen. The whole thing fails. However, the war ends. The Germans, of course, get miserably defeated. But there is a problem. The Indian troops who had gone to fight in the war begin to come home. And remember, this is 1919, they're coming back home. But in 1915, the same troops had nearly revolted under the Gadarites of Rashbehari Bose and others, and of course the Sikhs of North America. So what happens here is that the British are extremely concerned that this bunch, now they have, by the way, they are veterans, they have lost the fear of killing the white man, and so they're coming back and they may revolt. And that's the context in which the Rowlatt Acts are formed. And this is why when even there is small protests, they basically go and shoot them down. One of those incidents, by the way, is now remembered, but there were several. But the worst of them was, of course, the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. But there were several other massacres. There's an outrage against this. Finally, some of these revolutionaries who had been caught in the previous round in the Gadarite were released. One of them is Sachin Sanyal, who had been sent to Kalapani. He comes back and he organizes something called the Hindustan Republican Association. He then recruits the next generation, which is Bismil, Ashfaqullah Khan, Bhagat Singh, and Chandrashekhar Azad. This lot do carry out various activities. One group of them, the older group, gets knocked out by the Kakodi case and all the arrests related to that. Sachin Sanyal, by the way, is sent back to Kalapani for 10 years. Then Bhagat Singh, Chandrashekhar Azad carry on with this movement.
Sanjeev, tell us the linkages.
What I'm trying to show you is that these people are getting, each group is getting recruited by the previous group. So Savarkar and Aurobindo had recruited the likes of Rashbehari Bose. Rashbehari and Sachin Sanyal then recruit the Bhagat Singh, Chandrashekhar, and so on. And so on. So there is clearly a lineage. And then, even when you go to the, I mean, I'm going to cut short here because I'm becoming a bit of a monologue. Yeah. But even when you're in the Second World War, you see this INA being formed. Do remember, the INA is not formed by Netaji. It is formed by Rashbehari Bose, who after the first attempt in the First World War, escaped to Japan. And then in the Second World War, when he got an opportunity, he is the person who came and started the Azad Hind Fauj in Singapore. He was very old by this point, so he invited Netaji to come and take it over. But the point I'm making to you is, it's the same people who keep coming back. It's not randomly, you know, somebody stood up and began to throw bombs or carry out an assassination. This is a long duration, half a century of this.
That's the macro sweep of how the what is seen to be individual acts of heroism was actually a network, probably propelled by my next to next question. But before that, I'll get somewhere else. So not only was the War of Independence partly ahimsa and partly hinsa, the hinsa part of the violence part of India's war for independence was also a full institutionalized, if I may use the word, attempt. I want to humanize this. So there is a lot of abstraction in this. I want to humanize the pain that we have not seen. Bina Das, quickly, the pain of how she died.
Yeah, so one of the things that happens here is that after independence, many of these revolutionaries are simply forgotten.
Very short.
Yeah. So you have, for example, the soldiers of the INA. You have the sailors of the naval revolt. They are not even taken back into the military forces. They are not even, for many decades, not even recognized as freedom fighters. And then you have somebody like Bina Das, who was a very famous freedom fighter, who in the 30s had attempted to assassinate the governor of Bengal. But then, of course, she went to jail for 9 years, a little less than 9 years because she was released a bit earlier. She comes out after independence. She does serve for a brief while as an MLA, I think. But then what happens is that her husband dies and she goes off to Varanasi. And then, but you can imagine how completely forgotten, because she then drifts around the country, ends up in Rishikesh and dies essentially unknown. Is found, her body is found dead on the side of the road. Nobody knows who it is. It happens to be a nephew of hers who was looking for her, turns up in Rishikesh several days after her body had been found abandoned. and identifies her. But this is not the only case.
Second, so actually three of them brought tears to my eyes. One was Bina Das. Imagine fighting for fighting a glorious battle for independence. You win the independence. You do some things and then you walk away from it, never to come back. Your family doesn't know. You die a death alone on the road. And you are, how do people come to know? By identifying a body, not through any celebration or regret or any tears being shed. Ullaskar Dutt.
Yeah, Ullaskar Dutt, another extraordinary character. In 1909, in what is called the Alipur bomb case, he was, by the way, a key bomb maker of the Anushilan Samiti of... And he is sent to Kalapani. Now, by the way, it is important that you understand, Kalapani was not yet just another jail. This is not like going to any jail, ordinary jail. It was designed specifically to break the sort of the minds and the spines,
spirit, the very spirit.
And the spirit of those who were sent there. So it was one thing to hang somebody, but those who they could deem to be too dangerous to hang, to convert it to martyrs, were sent to Kalapani. And they were deliberately treated badly in order to break the spirit. So Ullaskar Dutt was sent to Kalapani, where he was regularly electrocuted. He was subjected to electrocution in order to essentially make him go crazy. And he was running this high fever. And others in the cellular jail would remember how they could hear him screaming in pain. And they gave him so much electrocution that he eventually lost his mind and he had to send to Chennai, what is then called Madras, ultimately to recover, and he was there for many, many years. Now, it is to be interesting to remember that these were real people. And just before he had been arrested, he was actually engaged to be married to a lady called Leela, who was his classmate in college, daughter of a famous freedom fighter as well, Bipin Pal. And the reason he later would say he survived through all this electrocution is because he would see the image of Leela floating in front of his eyes. So all of, through all that madness, the pain, the madness, the loss of his mind, he saw this image of Leela in front of him. But of course, it took him many, many years to get his mind back and to regain his sanity. But when he did, many years later, he then went and began to look for Leela. And of course, we discovered that Leela had actually waited for many, many years for him, had no idea where he had disappeared, because remember, he sent to Kalapani, it's not like you're doing a Zoom call every day. So she had no idea where he was and had assumed he was dead, and consequently had married and carried on with his life. So of course, he was very sad, but there's nothing much to do. Leela was married to somebody else and moved to Mumbai, so that was the end of that. So he continued in the freedom struggle and did various things. Now, at the time of independence, he was living back in his village in East Bengal. And like many other Hindu Bengalis in East Bengal, he became a refugee. And he moved to what is now Assam. And he was living there when he heard that Leela was now a widow and was paralyzed from waist down. So Ullaskar Dutt went back to look for her in Mumbai, traced her. She was then basically also living more or less alone in this, paralyzed lady, widow, etc. Brings her with him back to Assam, where he was living. Marries her after all those years and looks after her for the last few years of her life. So, this is a story that
could like this is a love story straight out of, I mean, it's beyond any film,
imagination. This is done it in film, you won't believe it. So, this is a real story.
It's so poignant. It's filled with so much passion for the freedom, for a love of a woman. That woman is now paralyzed. He goes, marries her. I mean, it's just evocative.
Remember, this is 1909 when he's arrested and 1947-48 when he marries her.
Final human cost or how... I just want him to talk about the human parts of... these heroes who were also networked, Chapekar brothers.
So, this is one of the earliest acts of revolutionary resistance. Now, I want to distinguish here just quickly that there is a difference between the earlier generation of rebels and armed resistance and the revolutionaries. The revolutionaries were a thoroughly modern phenomena in many ways. And one of the very early acts of this group was done by the Sapekar brothers in Pune. They were three brothers who were inspired, by the way, by Tilak. And what they do is, there is a plague going on. And of course, there were lots of restrictions, as we just ourselves went through. But the plague commissioner, Rand, was a complete extremist. I mean, he was using these powers quite obviously to push his way around, doing all kinds of things which were not correct. So there was a lot of anger against the British, etc. So what they do is, they know that this Commissioner Rand is gone for a event along Ganesh Khind Road in Pune. Though some of you from Pune may even know where Ganesh Khind Road is. And so they wait for him at night, and this carriage is coming through. So there's one carriage comes, they stop it, they shoot, turns out to be somebody else. In fact, Rand's assistant, they wound him, but he escapes. And then the next carriage comes in which Rand himself is, so they shoot him dead. And then they escape. Unfortunately, what happens is that they had some associates, friends, whatever we may call, the Dravid brothers, who actually informed the authorities about what they had done. So they are captured and they are both hung. But that is not where it ends. There is a third brother who was not involved in this assassination of Rand. He then picks up the gun and he goes and hunts down the Dravid brothers who had squealed on his brother. And he kills them. And then he is captured and also hung. So this story is quite an interesting one. An entire family's entire generation got wiped out. Three brothers got wiped out in this episode. And this is an incident in some ways that triggers the sequence that, for example, inspires Savarkar.
I now come to the third part of the books. The first part was violent actions. Second part was violent individuals but networked together. The third part is the moral, spiritual force that put the nationalists together in the form of Sri Aurobindo. Sanjeev, I'm so delighted you gave a full chapter, and then throughout it, this book for the first time has brought Sri Aurobindo mainstream. I wrote a book earlier last year, but that was on his writings. The contribution of Sri Aurobindo, then Aurobindo Ghosh, towards the independence movement, towards the freedom movement, is unparalleled in terms of giving not only organizing bomb squads, not only getting guns and other things, but also giving a moral force, an inner conviction, equating the nation with the Sanatan, the Sanatanata of the nation, the individual, the humanity, and how freedom becomes part of that, including but not restricted to violence. So this is the first time that you brought it, and we are deeply grateful to you. Sri Aurobindo provided the intellectual base, the spiritual strength, and gave the movement a spiritual strength, a conviction, along with Vivekananda, of course. But Sri Aurobindo probably in a more organized, he was the editor, he was a writer, he wrote books, he wrote pamphlets. One of the pamphlets he wrote was Bhavani Mandir. Tell us about that.
So one of the problems with Sri Aurobindo is many of his present day followers are almost embarrassed by the fact that he spent the early part of his life essentially as an absolute firebrand revolutionary. And many of the movements, even today in India, have their origins back in Sri Aurobindo. I'm going to come to Bhavani Mandir. But let me tell you a little bit about him. He actually was sent off to England when he was just 7 years old by his dad, who was an absolute British collaborator, who did not even want him to know Bangla. His father wanted him actually to become an ICS officer. So the only time he finally began, he rediscovered Bangla, rediscovered Hindi and Sanskrit and his own culture, when he was actually preparing for the ICS exam. And he came fourth or some fifth or something in the exam, but then refuses to take up the ICS job because he feels that, you know, it just wasn't meant for him. So he comes back to India, works for Sayaji Gaikwad of Baroda, who, by the way, was another great supporter of revolutionaries, very often not remembered. And he begins to organize this Anushilan Samiti, which, by the way, is a network of akhadas. And what he does is, using this network of akhadas, he begins to organize the revolutionary movement. So what you know as the Anushilan Samiti is actually a network of akhadas created using this network. And to give it a sort of a form, he writes a pamphlet called Bhavani Mandir, where he basically says that the idea is that there is a temple which to Bhavani, Bhavani as Bharti, as in the motherland, and he will have these warrior monks, sort of inspired by Anandamath, who will then go out there and create these akhadas to resist the British. The Anushilan Samiti itself was, of course, this. But why I think it is interesting is because Anushilan Samiti then led to many other groups. One of them, by the way, is the Communist Party of India, which is slightly better known. But perhaps the biggest organization that came out of the Anushilan Samiti is not recognized very much. It is actually the RSS. The RSS founder, Hedgewarji, was the Maharashtra head of the Anushilan Samiti. And incidentally, his code name, since they were all underground agents, his code name incidentally was Cocaine, just in case you want to know. Now,
can I just come in here?
Yeah.
So the track lays out, Sanjeev writes, this is the book. There is a formal, I'm supposed to have a book reading. So this is the book reading. The track lays out explicitly, writes Sanjeev, the idea of the motherland as goddess Bhavani. And then he quotes Sri Aurobindo. What is a nation? What is our mother country? It is not a piece of earth, not a figure of speech, not a fiction of the mind. It is a mighty Shakti, composed of Shaktis of all the millions of units that make up the nation. Just as Bhavani Mahisha's Mardani sprang up from the being of the Shaktis of the millions of gods assembled in one mass of force and welded into unity. The Shakti we call India, Bhavani Bharati, is the living unity of the Shaktis of 300 millions of people. But she is inactive, imprisoned in the magic circle of tamas, the self-indulgent inertia and ignorance of her sons. To rid of tamas, we have but to wake the Brahma within. Powerful lines. The pamphlet. The pamphlet is this thin, this
big. It's 18 pages or
18
something.
Pages. And irrespective of whether you are concerned about the freedom movement, history, anything, I would say it is essential reading just to get started. This is the youth. This is youthfulness. This is the kind of inspiration. It inspires me every day. I don't have my coat, but I usually carry it with me every day. Those lines are just amazing. You can get it at the ashram bookshop or
no,
even
it's a
on
PDF
Amazon.
Online.
Yeah, they'll have to hunt for it. It's a huge volume. Second part of Sri Aurobindo as the moral force was Sanatan Dharma. Explain that.
So again, so-called secularists of today find it embarrassing that Indians, particularly Hindus, were inspired by their religious religion, particularly the idea of India as a holy land, in their resistance to foreign domination. Now, this is ridiculous. I mean, this is an obvious thing that must be true. So, and it is, of course, true. Because do remember that the late 19th and early 20th century were also the period of great Hindu revivalism. Whether, of course, there is Vivekanand, there's also the Arya Samaj, which people have very often forget about. And there are many other, there's also the Sikh reform movements and so on. So there are a whole bunch of religious reform movements that are going on, which are strongly demanding modernization of an ancient civilization. But while they're modernizing, they're also very cognizant of the fact that they carry the weight of a very ancient civilization. And this pops up everywhere in the conversation that and on all their writings. Sadly, this does not show through very clearly in any of the narratives that are written up. Even by those who write about revolutionaries, they will quietly edit this out. So let me give you a sense of the initiation rites of some of these. So for example, when Sri Aurobindo is initiating his brother, Bharin Ghosh, into the Anushilan Samiti, imagine the situation. It's a darkened room with an image of Kali with a diya like this burning. And Bharin Ghosh stands there with a Gita in one hand and a sword in another hand. and takes the vow that he will give his life for India. So there were all these initiation rites which are very infused with Hinduism. And in fact, you can again read out if you wish this segment where, in an Uttarpada speech where Sri Aurobindo lays out what he thinks is the driving force of Indian nationalism.
This is another magnificent speech, another rousing speech. It is the only speech of Sri Aurobindo, Sanjeev, for you also, where he talks about his experiences in the jail or his experiences of meeting Krishna in the jail. He was jailed in the Alipur jail for 1 year and there was a trial. He was acquitted. But during that period, it is in jail that he met Sri Krishna. As part of that speech where he talks about, he says, I came to say something, but I have left that. Now there is some other energy speaking through me. He wanted to speak a different speech, but he spoke a different word. And one of those paragraphs, which brilliant editing and a great choice, Sanjeev, is this. Aurobindo, he writes, Aurobindo Ghosh. Then he was Aurobindo Ghosh. His transformation from Aurobindo Ghosh to Sri Aurobindo happened alongside a book called Karma Yogin when he went to Pondicherry. Aurobindo Ghosh, Sanjeev writes, would end his famous Uttarpara speech of 1909 with the following words. This Hindu nation was born with the Sanatan Dharma. With it, it moves, and with it, it grows. When the Sanatan Dharma declines, and if Sanatan Dharma were capable of perishing, with that, the Sanatan Dharma, it will perish. The Sanatan Dharma, that is nationalism. This is the message that I have come to speak to you.
Fantastic.
Rousing speech, which is another speech. It's available on internet, etc. You can just read it and file it away. I assure you, there will be a life before the speech and there will be a life after the speech as it has been for me personally. Now, Sanjeev, Sri Aurobindo has been cancelled. When I was writing my book on Sri Aurobindo, I found that he has been cancelled from the political framework, from the academic citadels.
By many of his so-called followers also.
I don't think so. They are taking slivers of his writings and pretending that that's the religion, which he said it was not. Nonetheless, he has been cancelled. For instance, if you search JSTOR, many of you must be doing research. There are only 140 entries with the word Sri Aurobindo. While there are 30,000 with Shakespeare and 9,600 with Plato. So you can take his philosophical writings, you can take his poetry, you can take anything. Sri Aurobindo stands cancelled, almost an apology, not even a footnote. By bringing him here, you have mainstreamed him. And I think, likewise, the way Vikram Sampath has brought Veer Savarkar into the mainstream, this complete erasure of our past, which is what I began with. There are so many of our heroes, physical heroes, revolutionaries, intellectual heroes. Sukthankar, who brought out the critical edition of the Mahabharata. We have no clue who these people are. But we know what Shakespeare wrote. We know what Tocqueville's philosophy on political science is. We know what Plato's Republic stands for, but we don't know what Sri Aurobindo is. So, very grateful to you for this correction. Do you see this increasing?
Well, partly depend on what many people in this audience do. My idea was to introduce them to some of their ideas. And by the way, this is just one of those interesting characters. Since you talked about political philosophy, let me give you another example of them. This is 1923. The First World War has ended. However, and subsequent to that, there was, of course, the non-cooperation movement of Gandhi, which takes off, seems to be heading straight for freedom, and then collapses. Now, this leaves behind a whole bunch of very disillusioned revolutionaries, many of whom, by the way, had participated in the non-cooperation movement of Gandhi, but they come back very disillusioned with, of course, non-violence and non-cooperation, but also with Khilafat movement and the Mopla revolts and all of that. And they're sitting around what to do. When Sachin Sanyal begins to put them together into something called the Hindustan Republican Association. And then he writes a constitution of that Hindustan Republican Association, and that's a very interesting document because he talks about the India in future becoming a fully free democratic republic based on universal suffrage. Now, why is this interesting? Because remember, this is 1923. The Congress is still only asking for dominion status, not for full freedom. And even the handful of people who are asking for Purna Swaraj and full freedom have put forward no proposal of what there will be when the British leave. So it is the revolutionaries who for the first time put down the idea of India as a democratic republic. Also, they are the first people to talk about universal suffrage. Do you remember in 1923, even women in the UK did not have the vote.
Till 1970, Italian women didn't have the right to
Absolutely.
Vote.
Absolutely. So if given that was the situation, you have here the revolutionaries who are acting for full freedom. They're talking about a democratic republic. They're talking about universal suffrage. These are ideas based on which India, the Indian Republic was set up. And these are ideas from not the Congress, but from the revolutionaries.
So the word that is constantly being used is revolutionaries, nationalists. But in the history books, you will not come across them. You will come across a word called extremists and moderates. You will come across Bhagat Singh being called a terrorist in an Odisha textbook, which was discussed in Parliament as late as 2007. I hope it's been removed, but I can't be sure anymore. The entire vocabulary, the narrative that has been built has been one of moderates having got us the independence and these extremists who are fluttering around and making life difficult for the rest of us. That's not true. So now I want to change, coming from the book, we will discuss the book throughout, but I want to now bring out the next set of questions, just four. Yesterday, when the book was being released, I was telling Samir that, you know, if I studied this book, I would probably fail my history exams. I assure you, all of you will as well, right?
Or the UPSC.
Definitely the UPSC. There are historians here. Now, you are bringing us the other story. And this is fact-based. There are citations to everything. There are references being given to, and yet this is not part of our curriculum. So when you write about the freedom movement, I don't know if that's taught in college level, must be, and you use the word revolutionary, probably you will get one or two marks less than if you were to use an extremist. So Sanjeev, what history do we read? There is one history which is being taught to us in school, which we are forced to learn, which we have to live by and stand up to. And then there is this real history coming out, or let us say, and you, if anybody has a disagreement, the book is out there, you can demolish it with all the citations there. But until it is not demolished, this stands as a truth. What history do I read?
So the fact is that much of what I've written, ironically, the material for it is lying everywhere. There is so much material because many of these, this is not a very ancient history. This is within living memory, some of it. Many of these people wrote their own lives as underground literature. I talked about Sachin Sanyal. He has written a book called Bandi Jeevan, which I am right now translating from Hindi and Bengali to English and will publish hopefully in 6-7 months. But in the preface of Bandi Jeevan, he writes, I'm writing this book not merely to inspire people of my time to become revolutionaries, but in the hope that some chapters of India's freedom struggle will be written down correctly. Because even at that, in the 1920s and 30s, he was apprehensive that the story will not be correctly told. But certainly what happens after independence is actually shocking. The revolutionaries, unfortunately, lose all their senior leaders. Virtually nobody survives till independence, who continues to be in the revolutionary movement. So Netaji dies or disappears depending on your belief. Sachin Sanyal, Rashbehari Bose, Bhagat Singh, Chandrashekhar, Azad, Thapar, Rajguru, all of these guys have either been killed or died under various circumstances. So what happens is that the revolutionaries, although they contribute enormously to independence and particularly in triggering the 1946 naval revolt, they do not, none of their leaders are around to actually participate in taking over power. So what happens is that one branch of the Congress party actually grabs power after independence. It's not even the whole Congress party. It's one branch of it that comes to power. And perhaps it's human that they emphasize their own role in... So the Nehruvians exaggerate their own role in getting India freedom. But that would in itself have been okay. What they do next, I think, is inexcusable. What they do is they go about deliberately editing out the role of other branches of India's freedom struggle. And I'll give you lots of examples of it, all of which you can go and verify. In the 1950s, one of the finest historians India has ever produced, called R.C. Mazumdar, is asked to write the official history of India's freedom struggle. So this is still 1950s, this is very recent history at that point. And R.C. Mazumdar begins to talk about all these other groups. Not just the revolutionaries, by the way, he talks also about the peasant movements like the Eka movement led by Madari Pasi. He writes about the tribal revolts led by, for example, Aruri Sitarama Raju, who now has become famous thanks to a movie, but otherwise had been forgotten. So he begins to write about all of this. And the Nehruvians are livid about and they remove him as chairman of the editing committee. He, of course, ends up writing another book, by the way, of some of his stuff, but the official history is edited out. Similarly, many of the sacred sites of these of the revolutionaries were actually slowly were being erased. A cellular jail is almost like the most sacred place of anybody from the revolutionary movement. People may not realize this. This, whatever is left there is only two wings. The rest of it had been demolished. In fact, even this would have been demolished, but for the last minute it was stopped. Mamsi, which is Maulana Azad Medical College, was the site of a jail where many leading revolutionaries were hanged. The revolutionaries in the 1950s asked that at least where the gallows were turned into a national monument. Far from it, it was demolished and some other building was built on it.
So let me come back to the question and rephrase it another way. You mentioned that the revolutionaries were not islands of courage.
Yes.
They were a network. You, as the new historians, you, Sampath, Meenakshi Jain, and others, when will your work see the light of day? What history do we read? Let me rephrase it even further. You've been a finance guy, and you know what insider trading is. You know what regulatory capture is. You know what market failure is. Now, what I see from a distance, and more so after reading books of by you guys, is that there is a market failure happening in the subject of history. There is an intellectual failure. There is even you may not even call it a failure. It's insider trading, where a certain kind of information is being pushed out. And yesterday, somebody mentioned, was it Samir or somebody, that should the government get out and allow private to come in? Or, as in the case, whenever the market failure happens, does the government need to enter, fix the market failure, and then step out for other historians to complete the conversation?
Well, the source of the problem was not market failure. It was actually government intervention, because as I pointed out to you, the government of the day in the 50s, 60s, 70s deliberately went in down, intervened, and actually edited out alternative histories. And even that is, by the way, an interesting history of how it was done, and I'll come back to it. But as far as the present time is concerned, the fact is that, first of all, at least the present regime is allowing new kinds of narratives to emerge. It may be even assisting it, for example, by Netaji's statue being placed on Kartavya Marg and so on. The insides of Victoria Memorial, by the way, have been converted into something called Biplabi Bharat Museum, dedicated to the revolutionary movement. So there is now finally some recognition of this branch of freedom struggle. But the point is, since you talked about insider trading, yes, the academic equivalent of insider trading is circular referencing. So you, and by the way, much of this is used in Wikipedia. You know, circular references are used to create a certain narrative. And that circular references is that Mr. X historian will quote another historian, will quote another historian, and once you go back and dig enough, you'll find that there is no primary evidence in this at all. They have basically referenced each other and built a completely ridiculous sort of edifice based on absolute nothingness. By the way, those who have read my earlier books like that of like Ocean of Churn, where I show you even the very popular narrative of Ashoka is on very thin ice. Anyway, this circularity definitely had the backing of the state.
So now if the state is creating this dichotomy not functioning within the academic confines of what truth or facts in history ought to be, where is the solution? Surely 25, 30 or even 100 books like this are not going to make a difference unless...
Well,
the teachers here or in
so
schools.
Some part of it is to at least get this open. You see, it's all very good. And I think what you're hinting at, should we go out there and begin changing the school textbooks? That's what you ultimately want to talk about. And the answer to it is absolutely. And it's just not about the freedom struggle. We need to change our history textbooks across. I mean, read our history books. No matter when you read it, you'll see whenever the battle happens, the Indians lose. Three battles of Panipat, Indians lose. Battle of Plassey, Indians lose. Kabhi bhi bolo, Indians lose. So all the battles, we must have won some battles since we are still around. So they all get edited out. So this need to revisit our history and retell it is absolutely there. And in fact, I hear that the NCERT is finally getting its act together and doing something about it. But before we get there, you see, we need to do one or two more things. There has been a long gap between the great historians of the up to the 50s who were still in a position to write things like R.C. Mazumdar, Jadunath Sarkar and so on. And then there was over a half a century when a particular narrative was imposed. So there is a break in scholarship, so to speak. So you did in the 60s and 70s, 80s have the occasional person who pushed back. You had, for example, Arun Shori. Now Arun Shori's put up a great defense in terms of a critique of what the left was doing, but he did not create an alternative narrative. And the problem here is, in the end, a narrative can only be replaced by another narrative, not by a critique. So what is happening for the first time, you are seeing other people beginning to come out there and write books. I have, of course, done a couple of books. There's others like Vikram have done it, and others are also doing it. Meenakshi ji and others are also doing it. So a critical mask of narrative has to come, along with it, the scholarship, etc. After all, what we don't want to do is to replace one bunch of lies with another bunch of lies. So the scholarship has to be done. And you know, it's a painstaking, painful stuff. I'm so unfortunate.
I think a lot of students here should follow that up. But again, Sanjeev,
when they will apply for
a PhD with a particular proposal, what is the acceptability of
So this is where, and I think we should maybe open it up to Q&A after this. Particular question. I think, sure, there's going to be an issue that although the teachers in various classes are still from a certain left narrative, I think there has definitely been a shift in the conversation that is happening. In fact, one of the things that is written very often by various people in Caravan magazine, etc., about how evil I am, is that we in class don't like this because our students keep standing up and quoting Sanjeev's book and questioning us. So the mood has definitely changed. The teachers may be the same, the students are beginning to question the narrative.
Before I open it up, there is one last question which everybody must know and you must articulate, which is the what you call collaborators and what I would call traitors. And how they and their families benefited after independence. You have mentioned Yashpal and you've mentioned Hansraj Vora. Tell us their stories.
So one of the tragedies of Indian history is we become independent. The revolutionaries are all in disarray. As I said, the leaders are all being killed off. But even those who remain are not really taken into the government, as so to speak. As I said, the INA and the sailors of the RIN are not incorporated back into the military forces. Far from it, they are actually not even allowed for many decades, not even treated as freedom fighters. So what happens is that the British leave, one branch of the Congress captures power, But by and large, they allow the existing group of people inside the government system, inside the economic system, to continue in the name of continuity. Now, there is a problem with this, that because of, as a result of this, many of those who came to occupy positions of power in independent India for the first one or two generations were those who had actually actively collaborated with the British. I'm not talking about the odd person who may have worked in the government or may have, you know, done some, was a, you know, school teacher in the, you know, government school, not like that. I'm talking about people who had actively collaborated as informers or members of the Imperial Police Service or contractors in the First World
War. Yashpal, for instance.
Yashpal, for example. These people became the great intellectuals of and thinkers and historians. You just, in fact, take whichever one is your favorite left historian, dig a little bit and discover their lineage. So let me give you the example since you mentioned Yashpal. Some of you may know that Yashpal is considered, after Premchand, the second most important writer in the Hindi language. And he was given every award you can imagine, Gyanpeet Award, Padma Bhushan, etc. After independence. Now, much of his fame is based on his writings about how he was a great revolutionary in the 1920s and 30s. It turns out, however, that there is very good evidence that he was actually a police informer. And in fact, it was based on the information he had provided that Chandrashekhar Azad was identified in Allahabad in Alfred Park, now called Azad Park, and he was killed. So the killing of Chandrashekhar Azad was really based on information provided by Yashpal, who then became one of the great thinkers of independent India. And this is true, by the way, of many of the leading lights. Again, not widely recognized, is that the British didn't quite leave in 1947. Much of the top bureaucracy of the government, military, and many other things continued to be British for a long time. The first naval chief who was Indian only took office in 1958. So from 1947 to 1958, the Indian Navy was run by a British admiral. Just think about it. And this was true of many of the secretaries of government, and the few Indians that were there but also, by the way, all people who had collaborated with the British. They are the same people who had ordered the firing against Indians and blah, blah, blah. So they and the next generation, their children, because of their, they were already incumbents because they very often knew because of their control of the English language and knowledge of the English language and other things. They became the leading lights of independent India, not those who had fought for freedom. And of course, they also wrote our history.
So it was a complete capture, political, academic, bureaucratic, army, and so on. I open the floor now. If any of you have questions, please raise your hand.
Yeah. Sir, namaskar. My name is Sandeep Singh. I'm from Lucknow. I came here for this session only. And would like to meet you. Add to the story of Chandrashekhar Azad ji. Chandrashekhar Azad's mother was still alive, and she was being taken care by one person who knew Mr. Azad. And after her death, her statue was to be installed in Kanpur, but it didn't happen. And the local MP, who was the collaborator with the British and who actually was co-opted by the Congress, he didn't let it happen. So there are a lot of stories, as you say. And
thank you.
The question is, when are we going to see a book about the collaborators?
Okay. Well, the book here does mention quite a few of them. So, and by the way, let me tell you, since you talked about the collaborators, one of the group who collaborated were ultimately became the origin of the Khalistan movement. So let me tell you a little bit about this. You see, in the First World War, the Sikhs were very much out there as a part of the revolutionary movement. They were called the Gadirites of North America. And they functioned out of a network of Gurudwaras. Now what happens is that the British, in order to subvert this, infiltrate all these Gurudwaras with collaborators and they pump a huge amount of money. In fact, we even know the secret agent who did it. His name was Hopkinson. Now what happens is that Hopkinson puts all these characters, and some of them, again, I name, there's a guy called Bela Singh, Arjan Singh, and so on, and they begin to essentially hunt these Gadarites in the Gurudwara system. So the Gadarite Sikhs begin to hunt them, and many of them get killed. And so there are all these gunfights that happened in all these Gurudwaras in Canada and California and so on. And then what happens is there is a court case in which Hopkinson has to appear. And a Gadarite Sikh called Mewa Singh stands up in court and shoots him dead. Of course, he's himself caught and hanged later on. But what I'm trying to tell you is that in case you have wondered, why is it that the Khalistan movement has such a strong hold in Canada of all places on earth and in the UK, the reason is that many of the Gurudwaras through which these Khalistan movement is even today propagated, and the effort that is made for splitting them away from Indian nationalism and specifically the Hindus, were actually the result of First World War British intelligence operations and pumping large amounts of money through to collaborationists.
I firmly believe that history is too important to be left to historians. So autodidact historians like you are absolutely necessary to bring a lot of these stories forward.
Thank you. Any question?
Yes, my question actually is something Mr. Sanyal actually mentioned, which is the fact that a lot of the communists in Bengal in particular were actually people who had been involved in Anushilan and Jogatthar in the 1910s, like Harindranath Chattopadhyay, brother of Sarojini Naidu, or Bhupendranath Datta, brother of Vivekananda. So I want you to think about, or I'm wondering if you've written about this.
I have written about them.
About the Anushilan to communist pipeline and how much of a thing it was, and how much did it affect the emergent radical sort of indigenous movement in Bengal and co-opted that.
The 1920s, almost nobody in India knew much about the communist movement. They only knew how they sort of, the first time they heard something about like Marxism existed is really in 1917-18 when the Russian revolt happened. So there's some curiosity about it. But even writing in 1930, Bhagat Singh in his Why I'm an Atheist, if you read it, it's quite interesting. He says that other than myself, everybody else is not a Marxist. They're all regular nationalists of the old school. So even as late as 1930, pretty much nobody in the revolutionary movement has anything to do with Marxism. Now, there are two streams from which Marxism come. One of them is more easy to digest, which is that some of the revolutionaries after the First World War have nowhere to escape. They're stuck in Germany, for example, and they escape to Russia. And they end up eventually in Tashkent. And in Tashkent, led by somebody called M.N. Roy, they set up the Communist Party of India. So Communist Party of India, by the way, set up in Tashkent in 1920-21. And it includes, interestingly, former Bengali nationalists who had ended up in there and a group of Islamic jihadists who had escaped from the Mopla, crackdown on the Mopla revolt. They had wanted to go and fight for the Sultan, the Ottoman Sultan's cause in Turkey. But then there was the Turks themselves overthrew the Ottoman Sultanate. So they had got stuck in Afghanistan. So they also ended up in Tashkent. So this is why, by the way, you have Malayali Muslim jihadists and Hindu nationalist Bengalis end up getting radicalized in a school in Tashkent in the 1920s. So this is one stream of where this radicalization comes from. Now, in the 1930s, some of these people managed to get back to India and they are sort of there. But there is another interesting source which nobody talks about, but I found lots of evidence for. The British in the 1930s began to also supply large amounts of Marxist literature to jailed revolutionaries in various jails, including in Kalapani. Now, the question is, why were they doing this? And it appears to me that they were deliberately having realized that this was a new movement that was emerging. And you see this repeatedly. They would always, when they saw a new movement emerge, they would subvert it by including some of their own people and, in fact, even encouraging it in some ways. They did this with the Singh Sabhas, for example. So they also did it with the communists. So by the mid-1930s, this Russian returned group combined with these newly radicalized Marxists from the jails appear. And what happens is that the British communists come to control them. And this is done by somebody called Rajni Palme Dutt, who was half Swedish and half Bengali, born and bred in Cambridge, who comes here. and he is a double agent and he controls this group. So the British basically control this group, which comes in great use in the Second World War because the CPI ends up collaborating with the British in the Second World War. Now, not everybody is pleased by this, by the way. So there is another group of Marxists, some of whom you named, who are very suspicious of this British-Russian-controlled Marxists that are floating around. And they are called the Anushilan Marxists. And they set up an alternative party called the RSP, the Revolutionary Socialist Party, which is almost dead today. There's, I think, only one MP from it, from Kerala or Bengal or somewhere. But they were an important group as well. So the Marxist branch of the revolutionaries, so there is the nationalist branch, which continues in somewhere else. But the Marxist branch ends up split between the CPI and the RSP. Now, the CPI, however, has one advantage, that it mostly exists in what turned out to be India. The RSP was very powerful, which turned out to be Pakistan, particularly East Pakistan. So it loses much of its power base at independence and kind of disappears or weakens out. But it still exists in something in the 1970s and is part of Jyoti Basu's government. And it invites a large number of refugees from East Bengal to come and settle in an area called Morijhapi. Now, Jyoti Basu thinks this is a threat. And so he carries out this horrific massacre of RSP supporters in Morijhapi, basically made up of East Bengal refugees. One of the worst, somewhere between 4,000 and 10,000 East Bengal refugees were killed in Morijhapi. Almost nobody knows about this. 1979. And many of them had links or came from this revolutionary background. So this was, in a sense, fratricide between the Marxist branches. And so this particular branch was literally eliminated.
Hi, good evening, sir. I'm a first-year student of political science at Ramjas Prem Anush Sinha. My question is, we often see, as you talked about, we often see that history is dominated by the left and Marxist historians. But we ignore the fact how the left, how the students who are new to this field are heavily encouraged by the left to write books that would fit their narratives. What stops the right to encourage students who wish to step into this alternate universe? That's my question. Thank you.
When I joined college, there was these Marxist bunches of people who would be hovering around me. I couldn't care less. I was busy with music. By the way, I performed at the law fac and I performed at the women's hostel. I haven't performed in arts fac yet, but maybe someday. At that time, they would come and say, "Where are your readings? Where are your readings?" I don't know if that's the expression here today. And those readings meant the Communist Manifesto, it meant Das Kapital, it meant some other poetry from Russia, etc. of those times.
I grew up in 1980s Kolkata. So you can imagine what I was subjected to. And one of the reasons I ended up in Delhi was that I would perhaps have been physically assaulted in university of that time. So I had no choice but to come here and study. But even here, there were these groups floating around. So the fact is that academia, even today, is very much a closed circuit. And even not just in India, by the way, there is a very strong ultra-left group which has captured even Western academia. And it's a very closed loop, very difficult to break out of it. So one of the reasons that in very recent times we have been able to do this is because, you know, outside of academia, writings have begun. By the way, you know, my first books were published by Penguin. And at that time, I know my editor told me that when she was editing my books, etc., there were others in the same room in Penguin who were shocked that she was willing to publish my book. And even when my book went for copy editing, all the word Hinduism was cancelled out and replaced with Brahmanism. You know, that kind of thing I have faced myself just a decade ago. And there was no way you'll get published in, you know, the media wouldn't cover you. You know, Adani's NDTV may turn out to be different, but the NDTV of 10 years ago, I assure you, wouldn't cover your books. It wouldn't, or maybe
no,
they would,
no,
but they
no
would,
no,
or if they did, they would deliberately present it in a twisted way.
And no Jaipur Lit Fest for you.
Yeah, things like that. These things have only opened up in the last decade. Before that, you go and look at who were appearing in many of these literature festivals,
Who were the people being published? No, his question is that there is all this literature available and there is entire ecosystem.
Yeah, so there's literature
jumping at you all the time. So what prevents
So you were physically prevented from doing this. So after the, it's not like there's anything natural about the left occupying the intellectual space. After all, as I said, in the first half of the 20th century, most of the literature that came out was not from the left. In fact, whether it's Vivekanand, Sri Aurobindo, Savarkar, Gandhi himself, or whatever you may or may think about his non-violence, agree or not, he was definitely not left. Ambedkar, now captured by the left, but ironically, explicitly disliked the left, and so on. So there were a huge ecosystem of writers, Lala Lajpat Rai, Tilak, you know, who were not from the left. And then they suddenly disappear in the 1960s. Because, you know, and you just have these rebels, one or two here and there, Ram Swarup or whatever, Shori or Swapan Dasgupta holding out. But this entire ecosystem of literature doesn't...
No, that is why I keep saying this is a market failure. This is an academic failure, intellectual failure.
But the market didn't exist.
This needs to get fixed somewhere.
No, no. So it was not a market. That's what I'm trying to say. It was an oligopoly with active state backing.
We should look at an MRTPC.
Yes, so now it's relatively recently that it's been broken up. And by the way, one of the things that has allowed this thing to break out is actually social media. So the fact that it can no longer be controlled.
Yeah, namaste, Sanjeev sir, Gautam sir. Sir, my question is very simple. You mentioned some very prominent names, Rashbehari Bose, and then you mentioned Subhas Chandra Bose. Sir, my question to you is that I am very much intrigued and fascinated by Bose's involvement in the freedom movement, right? So I have not read the book yet, but is there like an insightful, deep research about his role, or do you have any other project related to him? And sir, do you think it would be possible that if he came back afterwards, he was not supposedly dead or killed in a plane crash, do you think that Pakistan and Bangladesh would not have been separated from India? Thank you, sir.
Okay. I'll get the next question as well, and then I'll answer them together.
Good evening. I'm a UPSC aspirant and a volunteer of SAM, which is also an outreach partner here. So my question is, as sir, you said that Sri Aurobindo was cancelled out. Plus, sir, you brought out stories of forgotten heroes, right? Which we Samites also do in our programs. But my question is why they were cancelled out? Was it some specific philosophy like Sanatan Dharma ideology or a personal dislike due to which they were cancelled out or edited out, they were forgotten? What was it? Because if it was done in the past, it will be done again.
Yeah. So a combination of factors that came together very beautifully. And by the way, it links to the point about the Bose as well. So let me answer that and I'll come to you immediately. You have to understand there were several circumstances that fitted together. What the West wanted to tell you, what the new elite of India, the Nehruvian elite wanted to tell you, and the old collaborators wanted to tell you, and the Marxists wanted to tell you, suddenly happened to come together on this issue that the old nationalist narrative had to be deleted out. And it, by the way, happened partly because of what happened to Subhas Chandra Bose and the circumstances in which we became free. So go back to the beginning of 1946. In 1946, imagine how the world is. The Second World War is finished. All the soldiers just want to go home. And that's what happens. But the British soldiers demobilize, they go home. The Americans demobilize, they go home. But there is this large swath of land that is lying around that had been occupied by the Japanese in particular in Asia, by the Germans and Italians and so on. There are all these prisoners of war that are sitting around. So who do you think is controlling all of this? So it turns out it was the British Indian Army. From Egypt through, of course, India itself, then Burma, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, southern Vietnam, all of Brunei, all of this entire area is controlled by the British Indian Army. Now, this is not a trivial situation because at any minute, there can be a revolt in the British Indian Army. If there is one, this is not a India-specific issue. Suddenly, the colonial powers, the allies who had won this war will have a real problem in their hands. You're dealing with people who are equipped, they're trained, they have just gone through war, so they are the guys who won the war for you. By the way, they have hundreds of thousands of Japanese prisoners of war under their control, and they can easily rearm them. If they revolt, they'll release them. And now what happens is in many of these countries, you also have indigenous revolts. For example, I'll give you an Indonesia. In Indonesia, the Indonesian nationalists, when the Japanese were being defeated, the Japanese handed their guns to the Indonesians. So the Indonesians were armed. Now the Dutch, who had happily run away when the Japanese had arrived, now want to come back and reoccupy their colony. Now the Dutch don't have soldiers because they had been defeated in the Second World War. So who do you think is being sent in to fight the Indonesian soldiers, insurgents? The British Indian Army. And there are these pitched wars that are going on in Java, in which thousands of Indonesians are killed, but hundreds of Indian soldiers are also killed. So the Indian soldiers are thinking, you know, why am I dying for not even the British Empire? There's some other, his friend's empire, the Dutch Empire, this French Empire in Vietnam. I'm being killed for that. Why am I doing this? So there is this, and of course, in the middle of all of this, the INA trials are going on. You know, during the war, nobody had heard of the INA trials because of censorship. But now they're hearing about the trials. Then in February 1946, there is a huge revolt in Mumbai called the Royal Indian Navy Revolt. So this is the context in which the idea of giving India freedom happens. Because essentially the British are unable to hold on. The Allies are unable to hold on. There's revolt. The whole thing's going to be taken over. So this is the context why it is important to remember that if, for example, Netaji had come back and he had suddenly inspired this massive mass of soldiers, freed up the Japanese, all of the same, the game would have been very different. So he was not some trivial character they were scared of. They were really scared of Netaji turning up in the middle of all of this. Whether he died in that plane crash or he disappeared is a different issue. But it is no debate at all that him turning up at that moment would have been quite something. So therefore, given that these were the circumstances in which we got freedom, and by the way, I'm not somebody sitting here in 2022 who's saying this. You read, for example, Ambedkar has a very famous BBC interview in which he actually mentions all of this, this line of thought of how we became free. So given that this was what the case was, comes to your point is, it suited the Nehruvians then to sweep this story under the carpet, because otherwise their role becomes minimized. It suits the British and the West to sweep this under the carpet because they were them, because this other alternative reality was a real threat to them. It sweeps the Marxists to sweep this under the carpet because they had collaborated with the British against Netaji and the INA and even the Quit India movement. And of course, it suits the collaborators because, you know, if there was no India before 1947, they could not have been traitors to anything because there was no India. So given this context, the people who came to power and control the narrative both within India and globally, it was inconvenient to have this narrative for them. So it required another 75 years for us to come here, sit in New Delhi University and have to tell you this story.
Hello, sir. Thank you so much for this enriching talk of yours. I just have one question. Whenever we talk about India, we always use pronouns like she and her. But even after taking this into account, I couldn't help but notice that there were very few women about whom we talked today. I just want to ask you, taking this into consideration, do you think the contribution of women in this freedom struggle is being undermined? And how do you think we can bring it into the mainstream history discussion?
So the book, by the way, has lots of women in it. We talked a little bit before about Bina Das, for example. We also have Durga Bhavi, a great revolutionary in her own right, and without whom, after the Saunders murder, Bhagat Singh would not have been able to escape out of Lahore. And I don't want to tell the story because it would make it boring, so I'm not going to repeat that story. There were members of my own family who were very much involved in multiple ways. For example, when I told you about Bina Das, what I didn't tell you is that she used to practice shooting in area, this is now called Hindustan Park in Kolkata, which was then a new suburb. My great-grandmother used to train shooting with her. So they used to live in that area, and Bina Das's best friend was my great-grandmother, and they used to practice shooting. After Bina Das had attempted to shoot the governor and missed, my great-grandmother always used to claim that if it was her doing it, she would not have missed.
But without trivializing the issue, there is an other story, and then there is a gender other story, which we don't get to hear. In this book,
I've obviously focused on something else. But there is the case that there are many, Indian history is actually full of very interesting women. As it happens to be, unlike almost any other history, there are very few other countries where so many women are there. Durgavati, Ahilyabai Holkar, and so on. And again, one of the things that is happening as a result of this churn is the bringing up of these names. In some of my other books, I've talked about Rani Abakka, for example. And you have Vikram Sampath's book, by the way, has quite a few women in it as well. So this rediscovery of the women in our history is very much a part of some of this retelling. And of course, there are several women in the book.
Could it be that they weren't leading the movement? They weren't going and shooting?
No, they were. Veena Das definitely did. I mean,
in larger numbers.
It is the case that they were larger. So the revolutionaries did have women in them, and several prominent ones. Were the majority men? Yes, that is a fact of history.
For instance, the INA had several women.
Yes. So
but we only talk about two or three leaders. So could it be
a leadership issue? No, there was the Rani Jhansi regiment, and I do talk about it in the book as well. But it is a fact that most of the big leaders were men. But they have. I mean, the book is full of people like Madam Bhikaji Kama, for example, and so on. But yes, were the top leaders overwhelmingly male? Yes, it's a historical fact. I can't change that.
Thanks, Sanjeev. It's been a pleasure. This has been a very intense discussion for me. One last piece of advice. Go home. Go talk to your grandmother. Go talk to your grandfather. You will, after you read this book and talk to them about some of the characters, I assure you, more than half of you will find somebody ke mera bhi main wahan thi. Main wahan tha. Maine ye kiya tha. Wo hamare ghar se guzre the. Just as I found out this morning from my mother, that my grandfather was told by Subhas Chandra Bose to stick around in the Air Force and not join the INA.
Wow.
Thank you very much.